Welcome back to New Mexico Entertainment Television, where you continue to be in the know for all things events and entertainment in New Mexico. I'm Teresa Robinson, and on this month's episode, we'll be covering topics from our March issue, which is our food issue.
On this month's show, we have James Beard nominee and executive chef at Hotel Chaco, Mark Quinones, owner of Taylor Garrett Whiskey, Scott Fuel, members of the New Mexico band Superversa, Zach Kluckman of the Chachara Poetry Slam Festival, and our Music Minute featuring Phil Hamilton.
So, let's get started.
For Chef Mark Quinones, food is an obsession. The James Beard nominee lives and breathes his craft, making a name for himself in New Mexico and beyond. We're excited to have him here tonight to talk about his nomination, how he began, and what the future holds in his career.
So, Mark, thank you for taking the opportunity to talk with us today. I really appreciate it. And congratulations on the nomination. How does it feel to be nominated for a James Beard Award?
Well, thank you for being here. It's an honor and a privilege to be able to speak with you today, so I really appreciate that.
Thanks.
Being nominated for a James Beard Award, it's life-changing. You know, it's almost surreal.
I can imagine.
You know, you grow up, you know, as a young, you know, boy wanting to be a chef, and you start, you know, figuring out how the industry works, and you know, you figure out who the James Beard Foundation is, and you go, wow, it's like the Academy Awards for chefs, and you know, it always just seems like so far out of reach. Like, well, that'll never happen. But I'm gonna keep cooking good food, and you know, so for it to happen, it's like one of those like I gotta pinch myself moments because it, you know, it doesn't seem real. But it's real exciting.
Yes, I can imagine. So let's talk about how this journey began. Where did your love of food begin, that this became a passion and a career?
Well, my journey for food began when I was a young boy. You know, I grew up in the South Bronx in New York City, in Hunts Point, single mother. And, you know, she was always cooking in the kitchen. Her and my grandma always had food going, delicious food, right? Mm-hmm. So being Puerto Rican, Dominican by culture, watching my mom and grandma always throwing down, you know, rice and beans and, you know, whether it be fried pork chops or roasted pork or, you know, chicken.
This is making me hungry.
I mean, you know, tostones and plantains, bright flavors. And they were always making the marinades. You could smell it.
Yeah.
So I was always in the kitchen being nosy, you know, wanting to know how I went down. And I remember my mom taught me how to marinate turkey wings. I was probably like 8 years old. I learned how to make a mojo marinade, and I roasted them in the oven. And ever since then, like in my mind, I was like, "Ooh, I'm gonna put that marinade on this, or I'm gonna add this to the marinade, and I'm gonna cook that," you know. And then I learned how to make rice and beans real young. Mm-hmm. So honestly, like, not just to be cliche, like I've been. Since I was a young boy, this is all I've ever wanted to do was cook. I didn't have like any glorious kitchen positions. You know, I didn't work for like any like those famous French chefs. No, like I was a pot washer. And my first real kitchen job was on One Wall Street in the Bank of New York headquarters.
Wow.
in the basement. You know, that turned into like a banquet prep cook, a line cook. After that, I moved to Scottsdale, Arizona, where I attended Le Cordon Bleu of Culinary Arts, class of 2005. Had a great job out there on the Eagle Mountain Resort. And then I came back to New Mexico in 2007, believe it or not. And I've been cooking in New Mexico, you know, for the last going on 17 years. And I tell people the truth. I go, look, you know, I might be from New York, but New Mexico has made me the chef that I am today. You know, it's given me so much inspiration, and it's taking me in and my family in. So, this is home.
I honestly was wondering where, you know, leaving from New York and working in Manhattan and being here, just how that elevates your food, or where it starts molding. Like, how did you essentially craft your style of cooking?
That's a great question, you know, and I'll be honest, like, it's New Mexico. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, New York, I think, you know, gave me, I would say, the courage and like the thick skin to be able to, like, any situation that comes at me, I feel like prepared to handle it. But when I came here, you know, I became an executive chef in New Mexico.
Yeah.
You know, so by educating myself further on, you know, New Mexican ancestors, the spirituality behind this beautiful state, you know, factoring in that we're high desert, you know, what's available out here is the most unique, incredible bounty of animals. You know, the chiles, right?
Yeah.
You know, red chile, green chile, the most amazing herbs and fruits and vegetables come right out of the ground in New Mexico. We're very uniquely situated on the map. So if you go to our kitchen, we cook on cast iron,
yep.
little kettles. Our food is very flavor forward. It's wild game heavy. It's local vegetable and fruit heavy. So it's just modern New Mexican ranch cuisine. So all we're doing here is telling the story of New Mexican ancestors.
You have your French training. You've worked in New York. You have the New Mexico love under your belt. When you have that day that you just want to lift yourself up, the day may have been hard and you want to lift yourself up, what's that one dish that you go to, that you're going to?
Oh, my word. Okay. Just on a day off type of thing, So I'll tell you, it's arroz con maíz. It's Spanish rice and corn with sausages and fried chicken wings, Puerto Rican style. So we don't flour them. We get garlic, oregano, achote, olive oil, vinegar, a few other things. And we make this great, we do a little mojo marinade, and we soak the wings in that.
Mm.
And I fry it in corn oil, pollo frito, with arroz con maíz, so Spanish rice and corn and fried chicken wings with iceberg lettuce and a garlic vinaigrette.
So what is it about that dish that brings so much love?
That's the dish that my mom, you know, would always make for me, you know? And like, it was like my favorite meal. It's just a great dish that is delicious. It comforts my soul. And that's a dish that, believe it or not, like I've never really put on the menu. That's just for like, you know, when I'm away, like that's that one that I know, like that's going to always hit the spot, because like I only really see it, you know, when I'm in need of that comfort.
Through this journey so far, what has been the greatest lesson you learned in being a chef and following this career?
The greatest lesson that I've learned, you know, being on this journey as a chef has been, it's going to hurt. It's going to hurt. Perhaps more often than you'd like. You know, psychologically, emotionally, you know, and if you're going to take a deep dive into this industry, you know, be aware of your behaviors, you know, outside of the kitchen, you know, how you start your day.
Yeah.
Because it takes a toll, you know, whether it be getting a James Beard nomination or being told that, you know, this buffalo dish sucks, you know, every day your brain receives these really high highs and low lows, right? You're told multiple times a day how great something is, and you're also told how bad something is.
Yeah.
And subliminally, that can begin to compound on you and affect your mental health. So I think being aware of that is critical. You know, the biggest lesson above any recipe that I can use as a device to teach or mentor is let's talk about what really matters, because the cooking is the easy part. You have dreams about reading about yourself in a magazine or competing on a national stage or something like that. That's wonderful. But like, you have to be resilient. You have to have gone through a lot.
Yeah.
That can really cripple a lot of people. The best way to put yourself in a position to handle those opportunities is really, again, it's, you know, you have to properly hydrate yourself. You have to constantly educate yourself. And that's the lesson that I've learned day in and day out, is that how I treat my body, how I treat my mind will have a lot to do with what I put on the plate and how that's received ultimately by the guest.
Well, Mark, congratulations. You have an amazing craft for this art. And so it's, you know, it's being recognized, and it's not surprising. We've loved it here in New Mexico for years. So I'm glad that people are getting to see that on a national forum. You continue to represent New Mexico so well and love it so much. So I appreciate that, and congratulations.
Thank you so much. God bless you.
Same to you. We'll be back.
Whether enjoying it with barbecue or ending the evening with a nightcap, Taylor Garrett Whiskey provides a tasty concoction created in a fraction of the time through their accelerated aging process. Tonight, we're glad to have founder Scott Fuel talk about what the brand has been up to and what we can expect in the future.
Thank you, Scott, for joining us today to talk more about Taylor Garrett. So I actually want to start with, you know, it's been a while since we last talked. I think probably at least 6 years, around the time of the launch, actually. So what has come to fruition with the brand? What have you been up to?
Well, we've been up to a lot. And first, thanks for having me. And yeah, it's good to see you again. Has been a long time. And we've gone through some changes. We've changed the partnership, but we've settled in a place where we've got a really good production capacity so that we can meet the demand and meet the needs. We've seen a lot of growth since the launch of the product that we're very excited about. And hopefully we'll continue that and keep it pushing forward. We've also made a lot of changes to the technology, which is very exciting. So it allows us to increase the quality of the product while bringing the price down for our consumers out there.
Oh, that's nice. That's needed nowadays with the economy. So for those who are not familiar with the brand, let's go ahead and take a step back. Tell us, what is it that's unique about Taylor Garrett? Tell us about the process.
So Taylor Garrett was born from my idea that there is a shortage in the market of affordable, good whiskeys. Mm-hmm. And I love the idea of craft. So I started out learning how to distill and eventually built Taylor Garrett. How Taylor Garrett is different in the market is we're an accelerated age process. I developed a process that mimics the aging in a traditional barrel over years and reduces that down to a very short time. It's all science-based. Mm-hmm. There's no additives. Well, we use quite a bit less wood and energy in our aging process than is used in traditional aging. We use a quarter of the wood that they use in traditional aging. We also don't have to have the massive storage facilities for rickhouses, the cooperage creation and building of barrels, as well as the transportation of barrels. So from a sustainability perspective, it really does give us an advantage.
So this is our food issue. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about what would go well with Taylor Garrett. What food is calling for this whiskey?
Well, obviously with the oak and the smoke and those flavor compounds, the vanillas, the caramels that come out, that just screams for barbecue.
Yeah.
As well as steaks, any good meat dish, particularly your red meats. But chocolate always pairs well with any kind of whiskey. So
yep. we're going to be heading into the spring, summer. A lot of barbecuing going to start happening. So get your Taylor Garrett.
Absolutely.
For your barbecuing.
Absolutely.
So what should we look forward to in terms of, I guess, what the future holds for the product? What are your plans for, you know, promoting, taking part in events? What do you have planned?
Sure. So we've changed our strategy a little bit. We don't really have a public face to the company as far as a tasting room. And so we're doing a little bit more of a guerrilla type events, pop-up events, partnering with some of our on-premise partners that carry our brand, that feature it. So for example, in April, we're doing a Whiskey Wagyu night at 4940 out in Corrales. Chef Javi and the rest of the folks up there are fantastic. So
yes,
we're building a menu around that with tastings and pairings with the whiskey and some of his great creations. So that'd be a neat event for people to come try Taylor Garrett, see it with the different pairings, and see what we're all about. And of course, we'll do the festivals where we're out there with the public, mm-hmm, talking about the brand a little bit, giving them tastings. We've got a Burroughs and Mules that's coming up with associated with Cocktail Week in June.
Cool.
And different events spaced appropriately so that people can enjoy the product, see it, taste it for themselves, and get to know Taylor Garrett a little bit.
So where can people learn more about Taylor Garrett?
So, of course, we've got our website, www.taylorgarrettwhiskey.com and taylorgarrettspirits.com. Both will send you to the same spot. Talks a little bit more about our process and a little bit more about me and where I came from and why we're doing what we're doing. And, of course, we're available at most of your traditional retail outlets, independent liquor stores, some of the big box liquor stores, as well as several of the grocery stores around town. So we are available there. And then, of course, again, I mentioned a lot of our on-premise partners that really do a good job of promoting the whiskey, and you can sit down and enjoy their good food and have a little bit of Taylor Garrett as well.
Sounds like a good night. Thank you, yeah. Scott, for talking with us today about Taylor Garrett, and we are looking forward to seeing it more out in the public.
You're welcome. It's great to be here. Thank you.
Thank you. We'll be back.
I was a drinker, hell of a lover. I thought I'd never slow down. Drank from the handle, always half empty. Close every joint in this town. I drank all the whiskey till I couldn't stand. Stay out all night with all of my friends. Oh, but I never knew to tell you the truth. You can run, but you can't hide. When rock bottom whiskey runs dry. A few years later, I finally found out.
Hey guys, Chef Mike White here, here to tell you about the new season of the 505 Food Fights. This season is going to be unlike any other. But first, if you don't already know, the 505 Food Fights is New Mexico's best bracket-style culinary competition for charity. Chefs face off head-to-head in a timed secret ingredient challenge, hoping to impress our judges, sponsor, and auction winner to advance into the tournament. This season, we have 20 chefs that have not before competed in this tournament, joining four former champions as coaches that will hopefully lead their chefs to victory. Also this season, we have the return of the 505 Bar Fights. We have 20 bartenders that are going to face off head-to-head secret ingredient challenge, also hoping to advance in the tournament to become our new champion. You can check these battles out on Monday nights throughout the rest of the year. Make sure you follow online to see when and where it's going down. Our new host sites, Fuego 505, Hollow Spirits, Damasio's, Whiptail Brewing, and Oak and Ivy. We're helping local nonprofits all throughout New Mexico. Last year, between our season and our end-of-year tournament, we raised nearly $100,000, and we're going to blow that out of the water this year. We're helping nonprofits like the New Mexico American Foundation for Suicide Prevention, New Mexico Autism Society, Christina Kent Early Childhood Learning Center, Special Olympics of New Mexico, Breaking the Silence New Mexico, Capeless Heroes, and so many more. 20 battles means 20 nonprofits that we get to help. How can you get involved? First of all, show up at the door. It's only $20 to enter to watch this show live, and all those profits go to the nonprofit of the evening. The more people, the more money we have for nonprofit charity work. Buy a raffle ticket. We do a 50-50 raffle at every event, so you have a chance to support a charity while getting yourself a chance to win a fat stack of cash. Bid on our auction. Every single battle, we have an auction seat that we reserve. You get to sit with the judges, try all four dishes that come out from our chefs and all four drinks that come from our bartenders. One price, all to charity, and you get to try everything. Last but not least, you can be a sponsor. Every battle has a unique sponsor that has the chance to be added to our promotional material. They have the chance to sit with our judges as well, try all the food and drinks that come out from our competitors. Our gold sponsors also have the chance to get creative and choose one of the secret ingredients that our competitors are battling with. So if you want to be maniacal and have some fun at the same time, be a gold sponsor, help a charity, and get tricky with these competitors. Either way, just show up, have a good time, support our chefs, bartenders, and our nonprofits. We hope to see you all out there. We hope you can join us and be a sponsor. We hope you have a good time. We're looking forward to this season.
The Chachada Poetry Slam Festival is a new national-level poetry slam in Albuquerque. It features more than 70 poets from across the nation for 3 days of workshops and themed readings, elevating marginalized voices. Zach Kluckman, the festival's director, is here with us this evening to tell us more.
Thank you, Zach, for coming out tonight and talking with us about this new event. So I want to start by asking how this festival came to fruition. I mean, what was the process and what did you feel was missing in New Mexico that we needed this festival?
That's such a great question. Well, I'll start by telling you, honestly, I think I've been carrying this idea around in my head for about 10 years now. Mm-hmm. I look at other cities and states where they have these big festivals, Dodge Poetry Festival being a good example, and they're bringing a million people a year through for poetry, which is phenomenal. And I keep thinking, well, why don't we have that? You know, it's Albuquerque. We have such a rich history in this state of storytelling and oral traditions and art. And so that's been simmering there for about the last decade. And I've participated in probably every national and regional poetry slam mm-hmm. in the country at some point in some capacity. And so I've been watching, kind of thinking, all right, what, you know, cataloging, what works really well? Yeah. What could we maybe do a little differently and make it really New Mexico centric in that sense? And so I've been just brainstorming. So this was the year and I just felt it. I felt the time was right. And so this is stage one, right? So stage one is taking it the way it is now, because poetry slam is such an accessible way to get into poetry for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. You know, you've got the performance, you've got a really broad, diverse group of poets and people telling their stories and speaking their truth. And so it's very easy for people to relate to. So the goal here, I think, is that we take this year, lay the foundation with the Poetry Slam, and then in a year or two, we start adding in those more traditional poets, if you will.
Yeah.
Some of those folks who are winning Pulitzers and these big literary awards, so that eventually we have poets standing side by side working together.
Oh, wow.
Because I think that, you know, Albuquerque is such a beautiful city, and we have so many unique experiences that happen here. And I just want to remind all of us who we are as a city. And
you have 70 poets that you're looking to take part in this event.
Yes.
What is the process of how you're choosing them?
That's so much fun, actually, because what we're doing is we're sort of letting them choose themselves, right? Mm. There's a lot of cities still have active poetry slam scenes, and so they'll have a slam season where poets are competing all season, right? They go out and they earn points towards the final stage or the grand slam, and then the audience picks who the team will be that represents that community for the year. Mm-hmm. So a lot of our folks that are participating in the festival this year are those teams that have already been selected back home, and we opened the registration up and said, hey, come to New Mexico, come be part of this thing. And we have been fortunate to see poets from all over, teams from all over, as well as individuals. And we really just wanted to keep it inclusive and accessible for anybody that wanted. So, you know, we've got legends of the Poetry Slam scene that have been 20 plus years. We've got new folks that have been slamming for the first year, standing again side by side so they can learn and grow with each other. So it's been really interesting to do it that way, to just keep it as an open registration and see who was willing to come to New Mexico and show off.
Well, I'm sure they're going to enjoy themselves that they took this challenge. So what can attendees expect over this 3-day event?
That's a lot. It's going to be really amazing. So what we're doing is we've kind of broken it up. It's the competition itself is bracketed, mm-hmm. like March Madness, if you will.
Yeah.
So poets competing in the competition will compete every night. We're going to have 3 simultaneous events happening. So from 6 to 8, we'll have 3 poetry competitions happening in 3 venues. And then from 8 to 10, another 3 poetry competitions happening. And the poets that are competing will then be ranked according to how they do that night and the next night, and we add those scores up to see who goes to finals. So that's the poetry competition. But then during the day, through all of that, we also have free workshops. We have themed readings to elevate marginalized voices. So we've got our Visible Invisible Disabilities open mic, LGBTQ+, awesome. Indigenous poets, you name it. We've got a wide array of open mics. And all of these are things that anyone in the community can come participate in. So if there's a poet sitting at home right now and they're like, oh, I write poetry, I write haiku, come sign up for the haiku head-to-head match,
oh,
you know.
Oh, my gosh.
Absolutely. So events all day, lots of ways to get involved. If you live here locally, lots of ways to participate and learn with and compete with these poets. And then, of course, our final stage on March 23rd. So it's going to be a pretty sensational event.
So tell us about the final stage.
Absolutely.
When everything comes to a head.
Oh, it's going to be amazing. You said it. We've got the top four individual poets and the top four teams will get a chance to compete at the final stage. So out of 70 poets, we'll take a total of, 20 poets that get to compete for that title and the trophy and about $5,000 in prizes. So it's going to be amazing. It's Highland Theater over on Central. So really beautiful space. We'll have music. And I believe that Poet Laureate Emeritus Joaquin Bellamy will share something with us. So it's going to be a really full, rich night. And you, of course, you get to come see who makes it all the way through the competition, right?
I just love the fact that you're talking about, you know, starting small. I'm like, if this is small, I'm wondering what next year is going to be like. But we're dealing with this first year. So what is the date of the event?
So it's March 21st through the 23rd with the final stage on the 23rd. And if you want to find out about it or get tickets or if you see the schedule, you can check out the website. It's www.cicadapoetryslamfestival.com. I know that's a big mouthful. but just remember Cicada Poetry. I doubt you'll find anything else with that.
Wonderful. Well, Zach, thank you very much for coming in tonight and telling us about the event. And we are definitely looking forward to it.
Thank you so much. I look forward to seeing you there, I hope.
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. I'll be there. Thank you. We'll be back.
Superversa is the ultimate Latin-infused band that seamlessly combines different genres of music, mixing the best of Latin beats and drawing in music lovers of all ages. Tonight, we talk about how the band began, what inspired their sound, and upcoming performances.
Thank you guys for joining me tonight. So I want to start by asking, how did the band, you know, come together? How did that all begin?
Okay, well, thank you for having us tonight. The band came together actually a few years ago. The year was 2017 when everything started, or 2017-2018. Mm-hmm. And just a couple years ago is the formation of the band that is today. We're a nine-piece band, is when everything came to be a little bit more, clicked a little bit better.
And so it's anywhere from 9 to 10 people that are within this band, right?
Yes.
So, I mean, how do you even go about, you know, getting your sound, developing your sound? How, because that's got to be a lot of influences with 10 people that like all different kinds of music. How did you go about creating your sound with so many people in the group?
Well, I think part of what makes Superversa their music, our music a little bit more unique is that everybody has a little bit of influences. And everybody at the moment of making a song together or composing a song, everybody puts a little bit of their own, you know, flavor to it. Mm-hmm. And like, for example, I can speak, you know, for myself. I like a lot to listen to a lot of Spanish rock. I've met with great musicians. I remember back at UNM, Pedro Cuadra, which was an amazing flamenco player, and picked a little bit of things from him also. And, you know, I feel that everybody has that, you know, where they put their, like the little grain of sand, if you will, to the mix, to the melting pot.
Well, you guys are a New Mexico band. So, I mean, yes. I have to ask, in this beautiful state that we live in, do you find influence when it comes to the state that, you know, kind of
gets into your music?
I feel that we do. More just because of our language is Spanish. Most of us, we all came from Mexico. But being here in New Mexico, it's a different culture. And you get to just bring it all together. Mm-hmm. You know, we've all grown up here, so.
Really? One of the instruments that you actually listed, I thought was a typo. I almost corrected it. I thought it was supposed to be guitar, but it's G-U-I-R-O?
Yes, Guido.
Yes, what is that?
Guido. So actually a guido is a very traditional instrument that is used in cumbia. And it's a percussion instrument, yes. Percussion instrument that is well used in cumbia, and it's just what gives that flavor to the cumbia, especially, right guys, like typically cumbia, almost, you know?
Almost in all kind of Latin music, like mm-hmm. salsa, merengue, cumbia, jada, guiro.
Jada, guiro. And this is little...
This is the one that's...
Yeah.
Okay.
But if you play that music and you don't have that, you're like,
something's off. Very nice.
Yes.
Yeah, because the guiro add the flavor.
Yeah.
It does.
You were an extremely large band. Working together, I'm sure you have your moments. But what would you say is the biggest lesson you've learned working together as a group, as a team?
I would say we've learned patience together to get along because there's so many of us, how to listen to each other, and more than anything, how to spend time as a family. Because we see each other every single day, if I could say, or every other day, you
like
know.
Like at least twice a week.
Even even if we're not playing on the weekends, we're like, hey, what is everybody doing? You guys want to go out for dinner? Like, what are you doing?
I'm doing this.
Let's go out for some drinks. Let's hang out. Hey, let's watch a movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we are a family.
Yes. So where can we expect to see you? Where are some of your upcoming gigs that you'll be?
Okay, so our upcoming gigs, we have one on March 15th, right?
March 15th.
And actually, we're going to be playing with Baracutanga, which is another great local talent here from New Mexico.
Awesome.
Yeah. Right. Awesome. Baracutanga at Sister Bar.
Nice.
And then next day on the 16th.
Don't forget Joseph Canera.
Oh, and Joseph General. Yes, Joseph General. So sorry. Thank you, Gabriel, for reminding me. Joseph General is a great reggae band, also here, local talent from Albuquerque. Mm-hmm. And next day, we're going to be playing at Juno Brewery with 69 Avenue, which is our an extension, I guess you can say, our other little project that we just barely started.
Oh, my goodness.
Yes, not all the members of the band, but some members, including Asael Treviño Fraire, Gabriel Covarrubias, myself, and Gerardo Ayala on bass. Mm-hmm. We play a little bit of Spanish rock for everybody.
A lot of
soothing.
They play it hard.
Yes, but we hope to see everybody there and, you know, just come out, have a good time and enjoy the music.
Wonderful.
We're performing with both bands that night at Juno, so it's going to be an awesome night.
Gosh,
you're invited.
Oh, awesome. I will be there. I can't believe you guys have the big band and El Psychic. Oh, Jesus. Always playing something. Always something in the works.
Yes, you know, that's what feeds our soul, I think, as musicians, right, guys? Yeah. Like, we always have to be doing something musically.
Make some noise.
Like.
Well, where can people find out more about you, where you're going to be, and your music?
Okay, so people can find us on Facebook. You know, we live in a social media world. Mm-hmm. So you guys can find us on Facebook. You guys just type Superversa or Grupo Superversa. You guys can also find us on Instagram.
Watch this.
Superversa Agency Band. Yay! You guys got it. Awesome. Great. Thank you, guys. Thank you. It's like magic. It's some kind of magic. Right? Yes, but definitely there. You guys can also check our YouTube channel, Superversa. Right. We actually just came out with six beautiful songs.
Yeah.
Yes, six songs.
Oh my goodness.
Barely this year, right?
Yeah.
This year, yes. So we're making that, you know, that next step and just putting our music out there and hoping that everybody enjoys it and, you know, just listens to it.
And they're on every platform, YouTube Music, Spotify.
Yep. Every digital platform you guys can find Apple us. Music. Super Versa. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And check us out.
Wonderful. Well, congratulations. And yeah, I feel the passion. I feel the passion that you guys bring.
Thank you
so much for coming out tonight and talking with me. And we look forward to what you guys are going to do.
Thank you for having us.
Absolutely.
Gracias.
We'll be back.
This is your New Mexico Entertainment in 60. Belisamo's Irish dance company's Ring of Fire is a high-energy show featuring different styles of dance along with special guest performances. Rhythm of Fire runs from March 16th through the 17th at Wise Fool in Santa Fe. Lincoln Center Theater's award-winning production of My Fair Lady is coming to New Mexico, featuring the classic songs I Could Have Danced All Night and Wouldn't It Be Loverly. My Fair Lady runs from March 21st to the 24th at Polkjoy Hall in Albuquerque. Join the New Mexico Gay Men's Chorus as they bring some of the best songs from Tony Award-winning musicals, your intimate solos, touching ensembles, and big showstoppers from some of your favorite shows. An Evening with Tony takes place on March 30th through the 31st at the New Mexico Hispanic Cultural Center in Albuquerque. This has been your New Mexico Entertainment in 60. For more events and entertainment, visit nmentertains.com.
Thank you for tuning into this month's episode of New Mexico Entertainment Television, where you continue to be in the know. Join us next month as we cover topics from our April issue, which is our film issue. Have a good night.
For more events and entertainment, visit nmentertains.com.